Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Gangbuster, One Man's Battle Against Crime, Corruption, and the Klan, by Alan Prendergast, narrated by Gabriel Vaughan. Prologue. It was something the colonel hammered into his investigators. Find out all you can about your target. Start by identifying his associates. You can learn a lot about a crook, he told them, if you discover who his friends are. By his friends, you shall know him. The same could not be said about an honest man. More often than not, an honest man will have few friends. A truly incorruptible one might have none. If the colonel himself was ever to be investigated, you'd be better off studying his enemies. There were so many of them. Consider a single confounding episode, long after the colonel's gang-busting days were over. Shortly before midnight, on July 19, 1943, Phillip Sidney Van Cise, also known as the colonel, in recognition of his military service in World War I, takes the streetcar home after a long evening at his law office in downtown Denver. 58 years old, portly, and balding, he bears little resemblance to the trim, dapper war hero who ran for district attorney 23 years earlier, proclaiming himself a fighting man for a fighting job. As he walks the last two blocks to his house in the Cheeseman Park neighborhood, a stately turn-of-the-century three-story, he notices two men keeping pace with him on the opposite side of the street. Van Cise reaches the steps of his house. The men break into a run and catch up to him on the porch. One grabs him by the tie and snarls like a Hollywood hood, "We want you to come with us." The other man keeps his hand in his coat pocket, pointing something at the lawyer's belly. Van Cise is dog-tired and having none of it. Croaking out half-strangled cries for help, he wrestles with the goon yanking on his tie. The other man joins in the struggle, pulling his hand out of his pocket. No gun. Van Cise hollers and thrashes. The commotion sends dogs barking and neighbors to their windows. The men flee. When the police arrive, Van Cise tells them he didn't recognize the men. He doesn't know why anybody would want to kidnap him. But this isn't the first time it's happened, either. Possibly, he suggests, it was an attempt at payback by someone he put away when he was Denver's top prosecutor, back in the roaring 20s. 2 decades is a long time to hold a grudge. Yet District Attorney Van Cise did his job so well, with favor toward none, that the list of potential suspects is staggering. In addition to prosecuting murderers, rapists, and thugs of all stripes, the colonel set out to smash 2 sprawling criminal conspiracies during his single eventful term in office. The first battle made him one of the most admired and feared gangbusters in the country. The second cost him his job and almost cost him his life. Van Cise became Denver's district attorney at a critical moment in the city's history. It was a time when prostitution, gambling, and bootlegging thrived under police protection, when Denver's teeming underworld was ruled by Lou the Fixer Blonger, a shrewd ex-lawman who had something on everybody. Among the nation's top con artists, Denver was known as the Big Store, the place where a well-connected grifter could fleece rich marks out of hundreds of thousands of dollars without any interference from the law, as long as the fixer got his cut. Blonger attempted to buy off Van Cise even before he took office, a move he soon regretted. In defiance of the police and a mobbed-up city administration, Van Cise declared war on Blonger and his million-dollar bunco ring. He embarked on months of secret, often perilous investigation, involving techniques that were decades ahead of their time, electronic surveillance, undercover operatives, around-the-clock stakeouts, and communications intercepts, even counterintelligence measures, all to track and expose a confidence game so elaborate that some victims never realized they'd been swindled. The effort brought down the gang, upended the state's power structure, and made national headlines. At the time of the Bunco Ring trial, Van Cise was the most celebrated figure in Colorado, and powerful men pleaded with him to run for mayor or governor. When he left office 2 years later, he was, by his own account, the most unpopular man in the state. This reversal of fortune says less about Van Cise than it does about the great political and social upheaval that swept across the country in the years after World War I. After prosecuting Blonger, the emboldened DA went on to investigate the workings of a resurgent Ku Klux Klan in Colorado. Employing the tactics he'd developed for busting the confidence game, he sent undercover agents to infiltrate KKK meetings and launched a grand jury probe of the group's well-cloaked leadership and political connections. He was grappling with a rapidly spreading disease, far more insidious than traditional crime syndicates. His audacious campaign to rid Colorado of the Klan exposed corruption at the highest levels of state government, but it had been largely forgotten by the time the two men tried to seize him from his porch. It's hard to believe that any member of the Bunco Ring or the KKK would still be gunning for the colonel in 1943, so long after the main event. Con men don't usually get involved in rough stuff like assault and abduction, and it seems unlikely that the few Klansmen who remained in Denver would attempt such a move. But Van Cise managed to attract trouble and lasting rancor simply by being his stiff-necked self. Just a few weeks before the bungled kidnapping, the Rocky Mountain News ran a short, begrudging profile of the former DA, comparing him to Julius Caesar. Abrupt, incisive, a bit inclined to deal with people as if he were a drill sergeant, the anonymous scribe observed. A zealot and a crusader, refused to be a candidate for mayor in 1923 when he could have been elected without question. The sort that repels familiarities. His back, even at times of triumph, is seldom slapped. Some people go along to get along and end up with slapped backs and testimonial dinners. Others follow their own moral compass at great personal risk and are ridiculed as the sort that repels familiarities. They might even be attacked on the street for no apparent reason. The mystery of the attempted kidnapping was never solved. It hangs there, unexplained, an echo of dangerous times, a grim reminder that a man who dares to do what Van Cise did will be looking over his shoulder for years to come. The kind of criminal conspiracies he fought are still with us, in more sophisticated guises, and so are the deceptions that go with them. But we can learn a great deal about how to fight them from his example, the methods he employed, the determination he showed, the ways he snatched victory from defeat without getting snatched himself. He had a singular talent for sniffing out a con and exposing it. Whether it was a stock exchange that existed only in the minds of its victims, or a fat little man hiding behind a curtain, demanding that all bow and pay tribute to the imperial wizard. And, as his would-be abductors found out that summer evening long ago, if you showed up at his house uninvited, intending to take him by force, then that had better be a real gun in your pocket. The colonel was just the man to call your bluff. Part 1. Grifters. Lies were the foundation of my schemes. A lie is an allurement, a fabrication that can be embellished into a fantasy. It can be clothed in the raiments of a mystic conception. Joseph R. Weil, as told to W.T. Brannan, Con Man, a Master Swindler's Own Story. 1. The Fighting Man. Like many American soldiers coming home from the Great War, Phillip Van Cise found himself at loose ends. The war, and his part in it, had not gone as he expected, and the return to civilian life was not as gratifying as he'd imagined it would be. It was fine to have people fussing over your uniform, your ribbons and medals, including, in Van Cise's case, a distinguished service medal, honoring his exceptional ability as an intelligence officer. But settling into the peace was more difficult than he anticipated. By the time he stepped off the train in Denver's Union Station in July of 1919, shortly after his discharge, the victory parades had all been marched, the speeches delivered, the thanks of a grateful nation bestowed. He was 34 years old and had been gone for more than 2 years, including 16 months in France. The experience had been, for the most part, a disappointment. Having previously commanded a company in the Colorado National Guard, he'd sailed through officer training, received a commission as a captain of infantry, and patiently waited for a posting to a frontline battalion. But his superiors considered him to be more valuable as an administrator. He was promoted to major and assigned to supply services and office work. In letters to a cousin in Iowa, he complained of being stuck in a series of paper-pushing, do-nothing jobs with too much time on his hands. Time he spent learning French, reading Ibsen, exploring the countryside, and even, on one occasion, hunting boar. About all I can say is that I am practically my own boss, can go for a horseback ride, auto ride, or an airplane ride whenever I want to, and work on an average about 1 hour a day, he wrote. It is a shame the great number of officers who are over here with absolutely nothing to do. He finally went over the top, as the trench soldiers called it, in the Battle of Saint-Mihiel, the first American-led offensive of the war. He emerged unscathed and was put in charge of intelligence for the 81st Division, gathering information on the enemy's strength, location, and intentions. Promoted to lieutenant colonel and detailed to the general staff of the American Expeditionary Forces, he remained on active duty overseas for months after the armistice. In Denver, he had a wife and two small children, a son and a daughter. The youngest, Edwin, had been scarcely 3 months old when Van Cise enlisted. A widowed mother, an ailing sister, and a much-neglected law practice also demanded his attention, along with the city itself, a city that Van Cise had embraced, brooded over, bragged about, and quarreled with most of his adult life. At first glance, post-war Denver made quite an impression. It was the largest, most prosperous metropolis between Kansas City and San Francisco, home to 250,000 residents, roughly 1 out of every 4 people in the entire state. A regional hub for industry and agriculture, it also offered abundant amenities for tourists, including thousands of acres of urban and mountain parks, a mild and sunny climate, a well-lit downtown teeming with elegant hotels, shops, restaurants, and movie palaces, served by an extensive electric trolley system, and spectacular views of the rugged foothills and towering Rockies to the west. Tuberculosis patients came to Denver for its dry, clean air. Immigrants, primarily from Eastern Europe and Russia, came seeking jobs in its factories, stockyards, and smelters, where the air was not so clean. Civic boosters touted Denver as the top of the world, the mile-high city, and the Paris of the West. The official version of how the Paris of the West got so grand, the one recited by tour guides, tended to focus on colorful prospectors who struck it rich and blessed their adopted home with magnificent acts of philanthropy. The real story of how Denver evolved from a frontier settlement to a bustling city with cosmopolitan pretensions was a much tawdrier tale. It began in the late 1850s, when gold hunters established a clump of primitive encampments along Cherry Creek and the South Platte River. The gold petered out quickly, and civic progress stalled during the turmoil of the Civil War. But more substantial gold and silver strikes in the nearby mountains brought a flood of miners and speculators to the region. In the 1870s, the railroads and statehood came calling, and in the following decade the city's population tripled. Denver transformed itself from gold camp backwater to mining supply capital, providing equipment, outfitting, engineering, legal and financial expertise, amusements and diversions, a gauntlet of services and investment opportunities designed to separate newcomers from their cash. Not all the offerings were strictly legal. Laws against gambling and prostitution had been on the books since territorial days, but they were rarely enforced. In a red-light district known as the Row, hundreds of women worked in brothels, ranging from fancy bawdry houses to ramshackle cribs, scarcely larger than a jail cell. A short stroll away was a procession of saloons and gambling halls. At most of them, the house had not simply an edge, but a guarantee, thanks to loaded dice, rigged wheels, and faro dealers who were skilled mechanics. One reporter concluded that, of the hundreds of games of chance operating in Denver in 1885, all but six were crooked. Suckers who steered clear of the gambling dens had a good chance of losing their bankroll elsewhere. Three-card Monte dealers worked the street corners, and even the more respectable hotels and saloons had their share of gold brick salesmen and promoters of salted mines. The most brazen of the con men, Jefferson Randolph Soapy Smith, drew throngs to his corner stand by offering large bills, 20s, 50s, even the occasional 100, as prizes wrapped around bars of cheap soap, which were then packaged in paper and presented for purchase alongside other prizeless bars. After watching an ecstatic winner or two come away waving cash, frantic customers might pay $5 a bar, or even more, once Smith started auctioning off the dwindling pile. But the prize winners were all shills. Smith deftly palmed each bill as he wrapped the bars in paper, and there was never anything in the suckers' packages but soap. Smith had made enough at the racket and other schemes to own a piece of the Tivoli Club, one of the town's premier clip joints. Bunko artists like Smith couldn't have operated so openly without official sanction and protection, a trail of greased palms that went from the cop on the beat to high-ranking city officials. In 1894, a new Colorado governor, Davis Waite, attempted to do something about Denver's graft-riddled fire and police board, replacing the worst offenders with his own appointees. The fire board members refused to step down. Waite called out the state militia, which trained cannons and Gatling guns on City Hall. Deputized in response to the emergency, Soapy Smith brought men, guns, and explosives to the besieged building, determined to defend the city's right to embrace corruption as it saw fit. The tense standoff ended with Waite ordering his troops to withdraw. Pressure from business interests eventually did what the militia could not. Robert Speer, a land developer turned Democratic Party boss, ascended to the mayor's office on promises of cleaning up the city, literally and figuratively. Under the Speer administration, squalid Cherry Creek became a greenway along a grand boulevard. An abandoned cemetery became a regional park. The city center became a whirl of new public buildings rising above a neoclassical amphitheater and plaza. And Denver became a showcase of the City Beautiful movement. Speer also launched sporadic crusades against the most conspicuous gambling halls and the cribs along the row. The makeover did wonders for his town's image, but how deep the changes went was open to question. Speer was a realist, not a reformer. The idea was to control vice, not eradicate it. What evils we have thus far been unable to rid ourselves of are at least not hidden evils, he boasted in one public address. Of course, there is graft in Denver, but I believe all efforts are being made to keep it at a minimum. Spear's own ties to the not-so-hidden evils of the town were intricate and far-flung. He had friends and donors among the real estate interests that stood to benefit most from the civic improvements, friends in charge of the major utility franchises that made millions off the city, friends among the town's most notorious gamblers and gangsters. Reporters openly referred to him as Bunko Bob. Weary of machine politics, voters opted for a reform candidate in 1912, a shift to a progressive agenda that saw Denver shutter its red light district and Colorado enact its own version of prohibition. Yet the more cynical element in town regarded these bouts of moral purification as temporary at best. Denver had seen waves of reform, but they never lasted. The gamblers and madams and the opium peddlers hadn't been purged, merely dispersed to more discreet locales. The ban on booze, 5 years before the Volstead Act, gave local bootleggers a head start on the rest of the country. As if to underscore the fragility of reform, in 1916 the voters threw out the do-gooders and brought Spear back as mayor. He died of pneumonia 2 years later, halfway through his third term. Van Cise arrived back in Denver just weeks after the election of Spear's successor, Dewey Bailey, a Republican. At first, he was too preoccupied to pay much attention to local politics, too busy rebuilding his law practice and fielding invitations from civic groups eager to hear about his war experiences. In early 1920, he was asked to introduce the commander of the American Expeditionary Forces, General John J. Pershing, at a reception at the city auditorium. He worked painstakingly on his brief role in the event, which was attended by 12,000 veterans. But as he watched the new city administration fumble around, promising a crackdown on crime that it couldn't seem to deliver, he began to take an interest in Mayor Bailey. Even more intriguing was the city's district attorney, William Foley, who was said to be reluctant, if not entirely derelict, in the pursuit of his duties. A Democrat, Foley was described in the Rocky Mountain News as too good a fellow to make a successful prosecutor. Van Cise gave the situation careful study. Then he wrote a letter to a long list of friends and acquaintances, making sure the newspaper received copies. I hereby announce my candidacy for the Republican nomination for the office of district attorney, he wrote. Good government and good citizenship result from the certain and swift enforcement of the law. I believe in action rather than promises. As he readily admitted in later years, Van Cise didn't know what he was getting into when he set his sights on becoming Denver's top law enforcement official. He was restless, cocky, ambitious, to be sure. At the same time, he wasn't quite as naive as he sounded. He knew something about the forces and people shaping local and state politics from years of sharing an office with his father, Edwin, another restless man of high ideals and multiple occupations. Father and son also shared a painfully earnest civic-mindedness, born of inflexible personal convictions about right and wrong and proprietary pride in their adopted town. A crime or scandal that shamed their city was like an assault on their family name, or a dinner guest who spat on the floor. It was an outrage that had to be addressed. Born in 1842 in Adams County, Pennsylvania, Edwin Van Cise moved to Iowa as a teen. He taught in a country school, joined a Union regiment of volunteers, worked as a reporter and editor at the Burlington Hawkeye, traveled Europe as a correspondent for several other newspapers, and picked up a license as a Universalist minister before deciding that his true calling was the law. In 1877, he moved to the Dakota Territory and became a county attorney in Rapid City and a special prosecutor under the Hayes administration, charged with investigating fraud perpetrated by whites on the Pine Ridge Reservation. He then opened his own practice in Deadwood. In 1881, he married 20-year-old Adele McBrine, the daughter of Irish immigrants. 2 years later, the couple had a daughter, Ethel. Philip was born the following year, on October 25, 1884. Deadwood's most notorious residents, including Wild Bill Hickok and Calamity Jane, had already died or moved on, but the place still had its rough edges. In his youth, Phil encountered Sioux families camped on the edge of town, displaced by the Black Hills gold rush. He and other white boys bartered with the Sioux boys, trading kitchen utensils for arrowheads and tomahawks. According to family lore, the elder Van Cise represented members of the tribe pro bono in their claims against the mining companies. But as the mines began to play out, so did Edwin's law practice. In 1900, the family moved to booming Denver. Edwin set up a firm downtown, joined the law school faculty at the University of Colorado, served on the city's new Public Utilities Commission, and became affiliated with the Progressive Party. A gawky adolescent, Phil loved fishing, the outdoors, and trouncing all comers as the star of the debate team at Denver's East High School. He graduated in 1903, then went to Boulder to study at the university. During the summer, he worked as a reporter for the Rocky Mountain News and as house manager for his fraternity. In 1909, he collected his law degree from CU and joined his father's firm, Van Cise and Grant. Yet he wasn't ready to settle into a career behind a desk. Just months out of school, he became one of the organizers of an all-college man company in the Colorado National Guard. The 60 reservists of Company K soon established a reputation as the most disciplined and well-drilled outfit in the state. Their captain, Van Cise, was outspoken in his contempt for some of the other companies, a slovenly collection of Spanish-American war vets and ex-mercenaries. What was needed in the Guard, he insisted, was true professionalism. It was a cry that would be taken up by others, but only after a bloody clash between soldiers and civilians in a desolate place called Ludlow, a tragedy that reverberated throughout Colorado and much of the nation. On September 23, 1913, 11,000 miners working in southern Colorado's coal fields went on strike after years of enduring the deadliest working conditions in the country. The mine owners brought in strikebreakers and private security companies to keep the mines operating. Evicted from the company towns, the strikers set up tent colonies near the railroad lines and tried to prevent imported scabs from reaching the mines. Local police agencies, which were closely aligned with the mine owners, were incapable of stemming the violent confrontations that followed. Under mounting pressure from the coal companies to intervene, Governor Elias Ammons called out the Colorado National Guard under the command of General John Chase, a Denver eye doctor. More than 1,000 troops arrived in the southern fields at the end of October, setting up garrisons in Trinidad and Walsenburg, and establishing an outpost just a few hundred yards from the largest tent colony of them all, Ludlow, a makeshift village of 1,200 men, women, and children. At first, the strikers welcomed the soldiers as peacekeepers. Upon arrival at Ludlow, Company K was greeted with a band and union songs. Van Cise, who'd grown a substantial chin warmer, was known as the Captain with a Beard, and his men played baseball and football with the colonists. But the relationship quickly frayed. General Chase ordered the tents searched and all weapons seized. The strikers responded by hiding guns in storage pits dug under the tents and smuggling in more. An order prohibiting the troops from escorting strikebreakers to the mines was rescinded. The strikers, mostly Southern and Eastern European immigrants, started calling the soldiers scab herders. Even more alarming, former mine guards and local deputies, sworn enemies of the strikers, began showing up in National Guard uniforms. The most despised of them all was Lieutenant Carl Monty Linderfelt, commander of Company B, an army veteran who'd seen combat in the Philippines and as a mercenary in Mexico. Linderfelt had been working as a deputy in Los Animas County, in other words, in service to the mine owners, when he'd been called back to active duty in the Guard, along with his two brothers. In the months that followed, Linderfelt threatened or assaulted several strikers, earning particular ill will from the Greeks in the Ludlow colony, whom he referred to as Dagos and Rednecks, communists. He rages violently upon little or no provocation and is wholly unfit to bear arms and command men, as he has no control over himself, declared a State Federation of Labor report to Governor Ammons, urging that Linderfelt be removed. Van Cise thought Linderfelt was the worst man the Army could have put in command of a company at Ludlow because of his insane hatred of the strikers. It didn't escape his notice that while the men from Company K could visit the tent colony unarmed, Linderfelt's men always went in armed to the teeth, expecting an ambush. The strike dragged on through one of the harshest winters Colorado had ever seen. In the spring, eager to end the costly military occupation of two counties and believing that the strikers were close to capitulation, Ammons began recalling the troops. Van Cise's Company K went home in March. By mid-April, only a skeleton force remained at the military encampment at Ludlow, including Linderfelt's Company B. On April 20th, the day after Greek Easter, the colony erupted in gunfire, explosions, and flames. No one knows who fired the first shot or what provoked it. It might have been strikers seeking retaliation against Linderfelt, or a soldier reacting to a surge of armed men pouring out of the camp, who were reacting to reports that soldiers were trying to arrest Louis Tikas, a leader of Ludlow's Greek community. Within minutes, the militia had set up a machine gun on a rise overlooking the colony, and bullets were flying in all directions. Toward evening, soldiers began to move through the colony, setting the tents on fire and burning the place to the ground. By morning, 20 people had died, including two women and 11 children who'd taken refuge from the gunfire in an earthen cellar beneath a tent and suffocated there as the fire raged over them. Also among the dead were a soldier shot in the neck and three prisoners of the militia, supposedly killed while trying to escape. One of the dead prisoners was Louis Tikas, who had been shot three times in the back and had his skull fractured by a heavy blow. Over the next 10 days, the strikers exacted a terrible vengeance for their dead. They dynamited mine entrances, shot suspected scabs, and engaged the militia in battle on the Hogback above Walsenburg. It was one of the most violent insurrections since the Civil War, claiming the lives of at least 6 strikers and 24 mine employees, and it didn't stop until President Woodrow Wilson sent in federal troops. Van Cise returned to southern Colorado on Friday, April 24th, well ahead of the Federals. He was a man on a mission. The months of strike duty had postponed his plans to wed Sarah Reeves, a 28-year-old piano teacher and the daughter of a prominent Denver realtor. Now the wedding was only a day away, but he'd been ordered back to the strike zone to learn all he could about what would become known as the Ludlow Massacre. He sought out enlisted men from Company B, who told him that Linderfelt had ordered the execution of the prisoners and smashed Tikas in the head with his rifle, breaking the stock. Van Cise reported back to Governor Ammons on Saturday morning and married Sarah that evening. He had to cut short the reception after learning that he'd been appointed to a military commission charged with investigating the killings and was required back in the field. Van Cise accepted the appointment reluctantly, making it plain that he believed court-martial proceedings should be brought against Linderfelt and every militia member who participated in the burning of the colony. To his surprise, court-martial hearings were held, To no one's surprise, the hearings ended in acquittal of every one of the soldiers charged, except for Linderfelt, who was found to have assaulted Tikas, but without any intent of criminality. He received a mild reprimand. After barely a week of inquiry, the three-man commission issued a report claiming that the strikers had started the firefight. Some blame, the report added, lies with the coal operators, who established in an American industrial community a numerous class of ignorant, lawless, and savage South European peasants. That ringing condemnation didn't reflect the complexity of Van Cise's view of the matter. Although his own writings about Ludlow included a call for tougher immigration laws, he also denounced the Guard's efforts to investigate itself as a whitewash, and referred to Lieutenant Colonel Edward Boughton, the head of the commission and the principal author of the report, as a crook. When not in uniform, Boughton earned his bread as an attorney for mining companies. Van Cise resigned from the Guard in the fall of 1914, shortly after the death of his father at the age of 72 from complications of diabetes. His father had taught him about the law and justice, but Ludlow had been his education in the absence of such things. No justice for Tikas, for Linderfelt, for the women and children asphyxiated in the pit, for the men killed in the 10-day rampage that followed. His own role as inquisitor and whistleblower had won him few allies. Curiously, though, the bitter episode would not be the last time he sought out such a thankless mission, and ended up caught in the middle between labor and capital, trying to keep the peace and outraged by the lawlessness of both sides. The sequel came 6 years later, in the heat of his campaign to become Denver's district attorney. On August 1, 1920, Local 746 of the Streetcar Workers Union voted 887-10 to strike against the Denver Tramway Company. Cutting the 6-cent fares by a penny had been among the campaign promises of Mayor Bailey. To accomplish this, the company lopped wages, laid off employees, and trimmed routes. Facing more looming job losses and struggling to keep up with the rising cost of living on less than 50 cents an hour, the remaining workers saw no other choice but to walk out. The move left thousands without transportation. The company summoned professional strikebreaker John Blackjack Jerome, who brought in scores of armed men to operate the most vital routes. The situation deteriorated quickly. Strike supporters surrounded one of the few trolleys running downtown and derailed it. Strikebreakers sprayed fire extinguishers on the attackers. Autos filled with strikebreakers were pelted with rocks and bricks. Arrests multiplied. So did the violence. On the fifth day of the strike, a crowd of thousands marched into downtown in support of the union. It started quietly enough, but by evening, the demonstration had devolved into a series of scrums involving strikers, strike breakers, and police. Throngs engulfed two streetcars, overturned and demolished them. Another contingent stormed the downtown car barns where the trolleys were stored, only to be met with gunfire. Two streetcars were attacked outside the Catholic Cathedral on Colfax Avenue, forcing strikebreakers to take refuge in the church. An assault on another car barn on the south side led to more shooting. Hundreds poured into the Denver Post headquarters that night, enraged at the newspaper for its support of the company, and tried to wreck the presses and set the building on fire. At 1 a.m, after huddling with the governor, Mayor Bailey put out a call for volunteers to help his overwhelmed police force maintain order. The next day, hundreds of Army veterans showed up in uniform at the city's American Legion posts, reporting for special duty. They were sworn in as deputies by a police magistrate and issued white brassards to wear on the right arm, signifying that they were part of a peacekeeping force. Van Cise was one of them. Monty Linderfelt was another. Van Cise was put to work coordinating deployment of the volunteers, who were supposed to patrol residential areas and free up the police to concentrate on quelling any disturbances downtown. Linderfelt, hailed in the Rocky Mountain News as hero of many a hard fight, roamed the streets with his own entourage. He claimed to have 75 crack riflemen and gunners under his command, eager to respond to any assault on law and order. The Legionnaires formed cordons, closed streets, and told roving packs of belligerent young men to go home. Van Cise caught a ride in a truck with a machine gun mounted in the back and got no arguments from anyone. But after sunset, trouble boiled on the east side of town, where hundreds of strikers and onlookers had gathered outside a car barn packed with scabs. A touring car full of strikebreakers roared into the scene and was met with a hail of bricks. Gunmen inside the building fired into the crowd, killing five and wounding at least a dozen more, including several women and children. That night, the mayor made the call he'd refused to make the night before. Within hours, Denver was under martial law. Federal troops rode the streetcars and occupied key positions across the city. The strikebreakers were disarmed. The union called off the strike, but most of the strikers lost their jobs anyway. The riots, which in two nights had resulted in seven dead and more than 50 wounded, came to an abrupt end. District Attorney Foley summoned a special grand jury to investigate the strike violence. Some of the rioters who'd trashed private property were indicted, but no one was ever charged for the slaughter outside the East Side car barn. Van Cise was stunned. It was Ludlow all over again. He had no reason to expect that he might win the race for district attorney. He had little experience with criminal law and no political pull at all. All he had was his late father's sterling reputation, a few friends in the legal community, and whatever support he could drum up by touting his war record. His campaign brochures presented him as a fighting man for a fighting job, someone who'd served his country honorably and would be a fearless prosecutor, in contrast, say, to William Foley. Van Cise blasted the incumbent for failing to prosecute Denver Tramway's murderous hired guns and for his anemic courtroom performance in general. One-third of the criminal cases Foley had filed during his 4 years in office were dismissed. Foley had personally tried only two cases and lost them both. Foley wasn't his chief worry, though. The Republicans had their machine politics, just like the Democrats, and the insiders loathed Van Cise for running without their approval. The party leadership had its own ideas about who the next DA was going to be, and it wasn't a self-promoting nobody from Deadwood who didn't know how to keep his nose out of messes like Ludlow or the tramway strike. But Van Cise's timing for his dark horse run couldn't have been better. The boys at City Hall backed one candidate for DA, Henry May, and U.S. Senator Lawrence Phipps backed another, Omar Garwood. When the GOP primary rolled around, the party loyalists were split. Van Cise drew enough votes from people who didn't care for May or Garwood to emerge with the nomination. Alarmed at the upset, some of the Republican faithful began working to get the incumbent Democrat reelected rather than back Van Cise. Others set out to put an independent on the ballot, denouncing Van Cise as a pseudo-reformer and a martinet. His mind travels along a lone track. The rigidity of military discipline, all elements of humaneness obliterated, one of his critics wrote in an open letter to the public. Force, brutality, egotism run amok constitute a complete mental analysis of the candidate. In spite of all this, a stream of supplicants sought out the fighting man, figuring he might have a shot at winning. A few days after the primary, Leonard DeLue showed up at Van Cise's law office, all smiles and good wishes. DeLue had been a deputy sheriff in Denver back in the bad old days of the 1890s, involved in strike-breaking and street clashes over which gang of duly deputized toughs was going to control the ballot stuffing at the city's polling places. He now ran the biggest private investigation agency in town, an enterprise built on his extensive knowledge of the local power structure and his access to people from all strata of society. He offered Van Cise his congratulations and said he had a friend who wanted to meet him, someone who can do more to elect you than any man in Denver. DeLue didn't name his friend, and Van Cise resisted his attempts to set up a meeting. He didn't like DeLue and didn't see any reason to curry favor with his friends. But DeLue persisted. He persuaded another attorney to intercede on his behalf, urging Van Cise to be sociable if it would help him get votes. Van Cise agreed to meet the mysterious kingmaker in DeLue's office one morning. He arrived at the appointed time and found Lou Blonger waiting for him. Blonger was heavyset, with thick-lidded eyes and coarse features. His face was dominated by a bulbous, oversized nose, like a misshapen potato, that was both unnerving and comical. He was 71 and had been a fixture in the city for more than 30 years, with interests at various times in saloons, gambling halls, and related rackets. Van Cise had met him years ago, in the course of his work as a cub reporter, but knew hardly anything about him. There were all sorts of stories about Blonger and his shady connections on both sides of the street, from judges and party bosses to legendary gunmen and outlaws like Wyatt Earp, Bat Masterson, and Soapy Smith. Like his city, Blonger had ostensibly cleaned up his act in recent years. He kept an office on 17th Street these days, in the heart of the city's financial district, and referred to himself as a mining investor. Yet the moment Van Cise stepped into DeLue's office and saw Blonger there, he knew something unsavory was in the works. Blonger was soft-spoken and genial. He boasted that he was a Civil War veteran and had marched in Memorial Day parades alongside the candidate's late father, a grand old man. It was important for the vets to stick together, he said, and he was keenly interested in supporting the only candidate in the race who'd seen combat in France. He asked blunt questions about the state of Van Cise's law practice and his campaign funds. Van Cise admitted that neither was thriving. "Have you any rich friends who are putting up for you?" Blonger asked. "I've paid my own way so far," Van Cise replied, adding that he didn't think the campaign would cost more than $2,000 tops. $2,000? It'll cost 25 if it costs a cent, Blonger declared. I guess I am a sentimental fool, but because you are the only soldier on the ticket, I'll put up that 25,000. You can either have it now or call on me as you need it. Keeping his expression as deadpan as he could, Van Cise struggled to craft a response. The job of district attorney paid less than $100 a week. 25 grand was better than 5 years' salary. It was graft on a grand scale. But what was expected in return? He had to find out. "I don't know how to thank you," he said. "I don't need your money now, but I may need it. And if it costs as you say it does, I will certainly call upon you." That seemed to satisfy Blonger. He chatted amiably and to no apparent purpose for a few minutes. Then he began to talk about young men he knew, grandsons of old chums who were rising stars in the stock business. Their dealings were perfectly legitimate, but occasionally a client got rattled and made a complaint, dragging in the district attorney over nothing and putting Blonger in the position of posting bond until the matter was cleared up. It would save him a lot of inconvenience, he suggested, if Van Cise would agree to set the bond in such situations at $1,000. Once again, the candidate had to pick his words carefully. Low bail for peddlers of dubious stocks, so they could skip town without having to forfeit more than a fraction of their take? That was the ask? It was a clumsy play, and there was no way Van Cise could deflect it without declaring himself. I don't know anything about bonds, he said, but my hunch would be to fix the bond at double the amount the defendant is said to have stolen. Then there would be no question about his appearance at the trial. His frankness seemed to chase all the hail fellow soldier camaraderie out of the room. The gleam of interest in Blonger's eyes faded. There was no more talk of donations or bonds, and Van Cise soon departed. On election night, he took Sarah to the Republican Party headquarters to await the returns. The early count, based on ballots from the Central Business District, favored Foley. Van Cise could hear the cheers from the Republican County Chairman's office, where the chairman was hosting Blonger and a deputy sheriff named Tom Clark. Then the returns from other parts of the city started to trickle in. Van Cise surged ahead and stayed there, ultimately carrying close to 60% of the vote. Around midnight, Blonger and Clark made a noisy, profanity-strewn exit. Over the next few weeks, as Van Cise wound down his law practice and prepared to take office, he had occasion to reflect on his conversation with Blonger and pick at its implications. One December day, he phoned the man and asked him to come to his office. Blonger arrived in minutes, perhaps hopeful that the district attorney-elect had decided to take him up on his offer of financial assistance. For long moments, the men sat in cautious silence, eyeing each other. "Lou," Van Cise began, "what is your honest opinion of the conversation we had in September?" Blonger hesitated, as if looking for the trick in the question. But there was no equivocation in his reply. "That was the damnedest fool stunt I ever pulled in my life," he said. Van Cise nodded. As soon as he was in office, he explained, he would be going after the illegal gambling operations in town. Those with a financial interest in such businesses could expect to be shut down and prosecuted. Blonger listened with evident bafflement. "He didn't have anything to do with gambling joints anymore," he protested, "not for years." "Well, Lou, I just wanted to give you notice to quit while the quitting is good," Van Cise said. "You do what you want," Blonger snapped. Soon he was out the door and off to the races, he said, in Hot Springs, Arkansas. The reaction Van Cise had hoped to elicit from him had failed to materialize. Whatever the old scoundrel was seeking to protect with his spurned $25,000 donation, it wasn't a rigged roulette wheel or card game. It was something much bigger. Van Cise realized he was going to have to find out a lot more about Lou Blonger. 2. The Big Store. The man to see about how things worked in Denver was Hamilton Armstrong, the long-suffering police chief. Ham, as his friends called him, had been in and out of political favor over the past quarter century and knew all the players. No one had a better grasp of how crime was organized in the city or of the private arrangements among cops, politicians, and criminals that kept the smell of rot from permeating downtown and driving away the tourists. Shortly after his triumph in the election, Van Cise walked into City Hall, asked for the chief, and was granted an audience. Armstrong was 64 years old, a gray, sunken fellow with an imposing walrus mustache. It was as if the job had worn him down, like a relentless rain, leaving only the mustache. He had been a bookbinder and a state senator before taking the chief's job in 1894 as Governor Waite's personal choice, to oversee a shakeup at the force and a crackdown on illegal gambling. He had been brought back into office during subsequent spasms of reform and was now in his fourth non-consecutive appointment as chief. Known for spurning bribes and leading vice raids himself, he was good copy for reporters and a widely trusted public figure in a town where such men were in short supply. Months before the 1920 tramway strike, he'd been selected as an impartial arbiter, tasked with trying to broker a deal between the company and its workers. When the strike turned ugly, he'd been on the front lines and caught a flying brick in the face. Despite the chief's habit of calling everyone son, Van Cise liked him and considered him a straight shooter. But Armstrong wasn't inclined to share what he knew with just anybody. He suggested that the new district attorney see the situation firsthand before they had a serious talk. He summoned a police captain and introduced him to Van Cise. "Take him out and show him the town," he said. "What part?" the captain asked. "Every damn bit," the chief replied. For several nights, Van Cise and the captain explored downtown's seamier corners. They knocked on anonymous doors, got eyeballed through peepholes, and waited long minutes before admission, by which time any gambling equipment or booze in the vicinity had disappeared. They dropped in on rooming establishments that contained a suspicious number of single females, but no gentlemen callers. In Hop Alley, the remnant of a once-thriving Chinese community, they visited fan-tan parlors that seemed to have emptied of patrons just moments before they arrived, clouds of tobacco smoke still lingering over the tables. Bewildered, Van Cise came back to Armstrong for an explanation. Despite what the law said, despite decades of alleged reforms, Denver was still a wide-open town. That much was obvious. It was also clear that the police knew about the gambling, prostitution, and speakeasy operations, and that a system of lookouts and barred doors had developed to spare the cops, the clientele, and the operators any embarrassment. But why did Armstrong put up with it? The chief responded patiently, like a father explaining an unpleasant fact of life to a child. The lookouts Van Cise had encountered were only the beginning. There were lookouts on the police force, too, and in the district attorney's office. "When officers can get money for not seeing things, it takes an unusual man not to get blind once in a while," he said. He ticked off names. Ike Goldman, the city constable, who supervised jury selection in the misdemeanor courts, took payoffs from many of the gambling houses and brothels. Tom Clark, the chief deputy sheriff, whom Van Cise had seen hunkered with Lou Blonger on election night, collected from others. The bootleggers spread cash around several precincts, and the best bonded stuff in town could be found stored in the basement of the city auditorium, Mayor Bailey's private stock for lavish parties. "What would happen if you raided all these places?" Van Cise asked. "Say, you are green," Armstrong mused. "My raids would all be tipped off, and I'd arrest a lot of people but have no evidence. And Denver would have a new chief of police." The problem wasn't just a payoff here and there, the chief explained. The web of graft and corruption had been evolving for years, and now spanned the city, from the courts to the jails to the mayor's office. And behind it all was the fixer, Lou Blonger, the man who could spring crooks with one phone call and whose own operations were so well protected that Armstrong was powerless to oppose him. Blonger and his right-hand man, Adolf Duff, ran some kind of stock racket, but Armstrong didn't know the details. He'd once arrested Duff, only to see him released within hours after Tom Clark.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.